Christian historian D.G. Hart wrote, "True worship will be odd and perhaps even weird to the watching world." Christian worship is, in fact, a bold political act. It subverts the world's values by assigning glory and praise to the one whom the world despises. And as weak as the church at worship might appear to the watching world, the truth is that the powers of this world are no match for the power of God, who is present among his people when they gather to sing, praise, pray, and hear his word. Moreover, the church must reject the claim that worship is old-fashioned, irrelevant, and isolated from the real world. For believers, the church at worship is the real world. Welcome to the real world. This morning, as we continue our journey through the book of Acts, as we've been going through this book, maybe some of you have noticed with me that there are some particular themes that keep coming up again and again. And one theme that we're going to see again today, which Hart just mentioned here, is that there will always be those who despise worshipers of the true King, Jesus. Following Jesus will always subvert the world's values in some way. And we see that in the book of Acts. But there's another theme that we continue to see in the book of Acts over and over again. And that theme is that Jesus is enough. Jesus is enough for his people. Yes, following Jesus is hard, but it is worth it. Not because following him necessarily makes our lives easier or more comfortable. It doesn't necessarily do that. But because the purpose of life itself is to follow Jesus. Because in walking with Jesus, there is a beauty that comes out of even suffering and trials that can result in joy. A beauty and a joy that can't come anywhere else. You know, I think it's easy to look at the sin and the death and the misery of the world around us and to think, how can God allow this? I think all of us face that. How could God allow this? How could this be God's plan? Why does he do this? And this week, as I was thinking through this, the movie Schindler's List came into mind. Maybe some of you have seen it. In that movie, it's a movie about the story of Oscar Schindler. It's based on the true story of Oscar Schindler. And there's this scene where Oscar Schindler, who's a member of the Nazi party, is standing up on a hill. And he's overlooking the Jewish district of a German city. And at that particular moment, all these German soldiers were coming through the city. And they were evacuating the city of all of its Jews. And any Jew who resisted was shot on the spot. And it's this scene of absolute chaos and devastation. There are soldiers who are just crowding masses of people onto the street and Jews being herded into train cars to send them off to concentration camps. And in the midst of all of this evil and losses, Oscar Schindler is watching up on this hill, all these people who are dying and all this yelling and chaos going on. In the midst of all of that, there's this little girl. And she's maybe 4 or 5 years old, and she's wearing a red jacket. And the rest of the film is all in black and white, but here's this girl in red, wandering down the street, and she has no family members or friends with her. She seems to be oblivious to everything else that's going on around her. And Oscar Schindler sees her from the distance, and it becomes this turning point for him. Here's this child, this little girl, one who has done nothing to cause all these evils of war and devastation. Here she is, a picture of innocence, and she's surrounded by all this. And that was the moment that Oskar Schindler, that once loyal Nazi Party member, becomes a man who would work to save over 1,000 Jews from certain death in concentration camps. We don't have all the answers. We don't know all the reasons as to why God permits what he permits. We will never know, perhaps, until heaven. But God's word tells us in the midst of great suffering, in the midst of great persecution, that God is able to redeem and even bring joy out of suffering to his people. Our passage in Acts this morning will hold both persecution and joy. So let's see together what the Lord does in this passage. And I want to invite you to stand with me, if you're able, for the reading of God's word. This is Acts chapter 8. I'll be reading verses 1 through 8. I'm in the English Standard Version. And Saul approved of his execution. And there arose on that day a great persecution against the church in Jerusalem, and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Devout men buried Stephen and made great lamentation over him. But Saul was ravaging the church, and entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison. Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. You join me in prayer once again. Father, you are able to provide for your people who are persecuted. Oh Lord, your word in the book of Isaiah speaks of how you provide for those who grieve in Zion and give them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of despair. Father, your word assures us that you will make all things beautiful in their time. Lord, help us now as we live in a world full of the ugliness of sin. Father, please nourish us with your word this morning. Feed us with the beauty of the gospel so that we might be strengthened for what lies ahead. Renew us. Give us joy this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. And please be seated. So our outline for today is going to focus on three points. First of all, Saul comes on the scene. Secondly, a choice for the church. And third, the joy of proclamation. You know, verse 1 of chapter 8 here starts abruptly. It says, and Saul approved of his execution. And if you weren't with us last week, you might be thinking, well, what execution is this talking about? You look back a few verses and you'll find that the very first Christian martyr, the first person who was killed for taking the name of Jesus Christ, Stephen, had just been killed. This deacon had just been killed. And Saul was there. It said back in chapter 7, verse 58, and the witnesses laid down their garments at the feet of a young man named Saul. Saul, he was a young Pharisee. He was very involved in the murder of Stephen, who was one of the first deacons of the church. And verse 1 here shows us that Saul was happy with this murder. It almost sounds a little bit like a political campaign ad, doesn't it? I'm Saul of Tarsus, and I approve of this execution. Saul, the Pharisee, has now emerged in the book of Acts as the most prominent persecutor of Christians. No one else here is named in Luke's history as being so brutal and so thorough with putting Christians into prison. Saul becomes infamous among the new Christians, among the young church, as one who is absolutely opposed to the message of Christ, even to the point of imprisoning and killing those who persist to preach the gospel. Of course, I'm sure that many of you, probably most of you know, that this same man would be more well known as the Apostle Paul, one who had become dramatically converted to Christ on the road to Damascus. But Paul's earlier life here is pretty well known. He talks about it several times in the New Testament. Later in the book of Acts, Paul says here, I am a Jew. I was born in Tarsus in Cilicia, but I was brought up in this city. He's talking about Jerusalem. He was educated at the feet of Gamaliel, according to the strict manner of the law of our fathers, being zealous for God, as all of you are this day. I persecuted this way the Christians. I persecuted them to the death, binding and delivering to prison both men and women, as the high priest and the whole council of elders can bear me witness. Saul was known to the Sanhedrin as one who despised Christians. Followers of Jesus were a stain on Judaism that needed to be blotted out and removed by any means possible. In his letter to the Galatians, chapter 1, Paul said, "For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my people, so extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers." Saul's goal was clear: eradicate Christianity. And he did it so well as a young man that he went beyond the other young Pharisees of his age. In Philippians 3, Paul writes, "If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. I was circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless." Saul was a model Pharisee. He was everything that traditional Jewish society taught him that he ought to be. He was utterly dedicated to outwardly obeying the law of Moses. He was a Hebrew of Hebrews. He was blameless in the eyes of those around him. And the result of perfectly following this system of thought to its ideological ends made him a murderer. He had followed this particular path of Judaism that the Pharisees had taught. He was dedicated to the Pharisees' understanding of the law, and this is where it took him. It says back in Acts 8, verse 3, "Saul was ravaging the church, and entering house after house, he dragged off men and women and committed them to prison." The Greek word here that is translated as ravaging is the word lumino. It means to corrupt, to destroy, to annihilate. That is where Saul's Judaism took him. Was it really such a surprise? You know, Saul was following in the footsteps of his fathers. The generation of Pharisees who trained Saul were the same ones who were constantly plotting Jesus' death. It's possible that a young Saul may have even watched his elders make their plans to kill Jesus, or watched as Judas came to meet with the chief priests in the temple. This was the logical outcome of what Jewish civic religion had become. It had little to do with actually knowing God, but it had everything to do with maintaining what they believed was a level of outward holiness that made them acceptable to God. The layers and layers of Jewish tradition and rules upon rules had become so oppressive that it just dominated every area of Jewish life. And the chief priests and the Pharisees, they were the ones who interpreted these laws to the people, exercising power over their daily life. In that system, their interpretation of the law so dominated the eternal destiny of ordinary Jews. It gave them this incredible power over the people. So when Christianity comes onto the scene, they did everything they could do to stop it, including killing and imprisoning innocent people. You know, back in John chapter 16, verse 2, Jesus had said to his disciples, "The hour is coming when whoever kills you will think that he is offering service to God." May God save the church in America, that we never fall into that same kind of temptation, or that same kind of hatred or lust for power. But back here in Acts chapter 8, in the midst of Saul's persecution, we see that the members of the early church here had to deal with some very difficult circumstances. They had to deal with a difficult choice. What are we going to do now? What are we going to do? Should we stay or should we go? Should we stay and face certain persecution? Should we stay and watch members of our own family get thrown in jail? Men and women were being thrown away into prison, locked up. Should we stay and watch everything that the church had accomplished just get ravaged by Saul and possibly destroyed? Stay and endure torture and possibly even death, just like Stephen, just like Jesus had himself? Or should they go? Should they go and leave behind the fellowship of these new brothers and sisters in Christ? Go and leave behind the security of a church body that gave sacrificially to care for each other's needs? Go and leave behind the apostles' teaching that was training them. The apostles were staying. it says, the text tells us. Go and face the reality that they may feel as though they're on their own in a place where no one else knew about Jesus. Go and face the fact that other towns, other people might be just as opposed to the gospel as Saul was. What was this early church to do? Should they stay or should they go? Well, the text tells us what did happen. Verse 1 says that they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. So it sounds like most of the believers did have to leave, but the apostles stayed. It also talks about some others, some devout men who stayed and lamented Stephen's death. So there were a few others who stayed behind. But, you know, I think it's really interesting here that God's word doesn't assign any particular moral value. It doesn't say that there was a right or a wrong option here. It must have taken a great deal of courage for the apostles and others to stay behind, knowing that there was going to be more persecution. This time, with this persecution, they had to watch as more and more people were being thrown into prison for following Jesus. I mean, before, for the apostles, it was just them going to prison. But now the people that they were leading were all in danger. I'm sure this was a difficult trial for them, you know? I mean, it's one thing to have to endure pain for yourself. It's another thing to have to watch people that you love go through it. And then, on top of that, the apostles see the whole church is scattered. This church, this body that cared for each other and that the apostles had spent all of their time gathering and teaching was now scattered. You know, it's almost like the first church split. And it's not because of any kind of internal disagreement. It's because people's lives were now on the line, and many of them literally had to split if they were going to stay out of jail and stay alive. So the apostles stayed. Some others stayed. But the multitudes that had been gathered before, they're now a thing of the past. The ones who stayed had to go into hiding. And we know that because when Saul eventually comes back to Jerusalem after his conversion, we'll see this in the next chapter, he couldn't find the disciples. He had to be brought to them by Barnabas because they were afraid of him. They were in hiding. There would be no more crowds gathering at the temple to hear the apostles preaching. The megachurch that was there on the day of Pentecost had come and gone. So what can we learn? What can we learn from all this today? You know, I think there's a tendency for Christians in America to think, well, look at those huge megachurches. Look how many people they have. Look at all they can do. Look at how big their staff is. Look at how big their church budget is. Look at all the programs they can offer their members. And we can look at the early church in Acts 1 through 7 and think, it is a great thing to have a large church. There are so many good things that large churches can do that small churches cannot. But it was God's providence in Acts chapter 8 here to scatter this megachurch of Pentecost. And it wasn't because the leadership was unfaithful. It wasn't because all of the people were too weak to endure persecution. That's not it. That wasn't it at all. God's scattering this church was a part of his perfect plan all along. Listen to what happens next in verse 4. It says, "Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ, and the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip, when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed." So there was much joy in that city. Scattering the church in Jerusalem here was exactly what God would use to accomplish his plan. Some of you might remember when we started the book of Acts that the last thing that Jesus had said to his disciples before he ascended up into heaven was, "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." It's like there's three steps there, three phases. That's the outline for the book of Acts. Acts is the history of the work of the Holy Spirit spreading the gospel from Jerusalem and then to Judea and Samaria and then to the ends of the earth. And up until Acts 7, the gospel really hadn't spread that much past Jerusalem. It was God's plan to build up this core group in Jerusalem, this church to a certain point, and then send them out. And what did it take to get them all sent out. It took this persecution. That's what got them going out with the gospel. And where did the passage say they went? It says they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. They're now on to stage two in the book of Acts. Stage one was Jerusalem, and now they're on to stage two. Once again, as scripture so often does, it shows us that God used the ugliness of sin to bring about something beautiful, something good. What man meant for evil, God meant for good. You know, there's going to be points in all of our lives where challenges will come and we have to make difficult decisions. Sometimes there's no clear moral path to say, well, this is the right way and this is the wrong way. For the early church, we see that God used those who stayed and he used those who left. He used both of them. He had a plan and a purpose for both of them. So for us, how do we make difficult decisions? How do we know what God wants us to do? Well, when there's no choice that's clearly morally superior, then we pick one and we seek to be faithful and obedient to God in the choice that we made. God isn't going to forsake you or forget you if you make the wrong choice. Our standing with God isn't based on the decisions that we make or even on our ability to obey him perfectly. That's what the Jews were trying to do, remember? Our standing with God is based on his decision to save us. Our standing with God is based on Christ's ability to obey God perfectly, not on our ability to obey all the laws. That's good news. That's a cause for joy. But listen to the joy that came to the people of Samaria when Philip told them about Jesus. It says, Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ, and the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said to Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. So now we pick up the story of Philip. Philip was one of those first set of deacons, and he went to Samaria and told the Samaritans about Jesus. Now, I'm sure many of you remember how the Jews felt about the Samaritans. Jews had a racist hatred of Samaritans, just putting it bluntly, almost as much as they hated the new church. One Jewish rabbi said, "Let no man eat the bread of the Samaritans, for he who eats their bread is like one who eats swine flesh." And you know that pork was unclean for Jews. The idea here is that Samaritans were an unclean race of half-breeds. They came from mingling of northern Israel and the conquering Assyrians back centuries before. They were like an obscene mix of Jew and Gentile in their ancestry. In Jewish minds, being a Samaritan was worse than being a Gentile. Who do you think were the last group of people that the Jews wanted to spend time with? It was Samaritans. And who were the first people outside of Jerusalem that God brings into his church? The Samaritans. When Philip came to the Samaritans, he proclaimed to them the Christ, and they listened with joy. Note that Philip came bringing signs and wonders. He healed the lame and the paralyzed and cast out spirits. And the text tells us that the point of those signs was to verify the message that Philip brought. Verse 6 says, "And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip when they heard him and saw the signs that he did." The people of Samaria saw the miracles and they paid attention to what Philip had to say. And what did Philip have to say to these Samaritans? Well, he brought them good news. Those Samaritans were now ethnically distinct from Jews. Samaritans also claimed to worship and obey the God of Moses. For centuries, the Samaritans had argued with Jews about where God should be worshipped. The Samaritans argued that God should be worshipped on Mount Gerizim, and of course the Jews worshipped down in Jerusalem. Both Jews and Samaritans were stuck in this system of trying to gain God's favor through obeying the law of Moses outwardly. But Philip brought them the good news. He told them about Jesus. In fact, just a few years before, Jesus himself had come through Samaria. And you might remember, he met a woman at the well, and she said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. And Jesus said to her, Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. And the woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming. When he comes, he will tell us all things. Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. The Samaritans needed the good news of Jesus every bit as much as the Jews did. They needed to know that Jesus came to fulfill the law of Moses on behalf so that they could worship him in spirit and in truth. They needed to see that Jesus has all power and authority over evil spirits and even physical limitations. They needed to know that Jesus could heal them physically and spiritually. They needed to know that in Christ is forgiveness of all their sin, reconciliation, and in being reconciled to God, they would also be reconciled to believing Jews as well. Their neighbors, their brothers with whom they had fought since the days of the divided kingdom ages ago, were now restored to unity with them again in Christ. As Paul said in Ephesians 2, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. There was a new unity here between Jewish believers in Christ and Samaritan believers in Christ. It was a unity that never could have come from anything else. I mean, these two groups of people had hated each other for centuries, and now they're being brought together through Christ. And this was God's purpose all along, to bring together people from every tribe and nation and to make them more united to their brothers and sisters in Christ than they are even to their brothers and sisters of their own tribe. And for the Samaritans, this was cause for great joy. The great pain and suffering that had come from the persecution of the church in Jerusalem brought great healing and joy to these new believers in Samaria. It was the fracturing of that church in Jerusalem that brought the reunification of Jews and Samaritans in Christ. The persecution that Saul had meant for evil, God meant for good. The salvation of many Samaritans and the healing of a wound that had festered for ages and ages. Friends, I don't doubt that Philip and the others, they probably wouldn't have gone to Samaria with the gospel without that persecution. I don't think it could have happened any other way. Samaria was not a comfortable place for Jews. It wasn't a place that Jews like Philip wanted to go. But it was exactly where he needed to go, and God made sure that he got there. This is what our God is always in the business of doing. God takes the ugliness of our sin and the ugliness of this sin-cursed world around us, and he redeems it. He redeems it to create something far more beautiful than it ever could have been before. Fyodor Dostoevsky, I think I said that name right, he was a Christian. And he was a Russian author back in the 1800s. When Dostoevsky was 29 years old, he was arrested and he was sentenced to death by firing squad for being a part of a group that criticized the Tsar of Russia. But at the last moment, the Tsar decided to have mercy and he canceled the firing squad, and instead he sent Dostoevsky to exile in Siberia. How kind of him. Dostoevsky wrote several famous novels, but in one of his books, this is what he writes. He writes, I believe, like a child, that suffering will be healed and made up for, that in the end, all the humiliating absurdity of human contradictions will vanish like a pitiful mirage. In the world's finale, at the moment of eternal harmony, something so precious will come to pass that it will suffice for all hearts, for the comforting of all resentments, for the atonement of all the crimes of humanity, of all the blood that they've shed, that it will make it not only possible to forgive, but to justify all that has happened with men. In our short lifetimes, we can't see far enough to understand much of the plan and purpose of God. But the message of God's word is clear. Out of great suffering, out of great evil, God will bring far greater beauty and even joy. That's the story of the Bible itself. At the center of the story of the Bible is Jesus, the one who bore all the suffering and all the sin, all of the wrath of God that was due to mankind for sin. He took that all so that he might save you and me and all who believe in him by faith. That is the story of the center of Scripture, that Jesus bore the greatest possible suffering so that through him we might have the greatest possible joy. I hope that your faith is in him today. Will you join me in prayer? Lord Jesus, help us to honor you in the choices that we make. Father, your words tells us that you are taking the ugliness of this world and redeeming it according to your good purpose. Father, please give us the grace to trust in you in the midst of our own trials and suffering as we go through this painful and sin-cursed world. Father, help us to remember that you will make everything beautiful in its time. Lord, please be honored in our lives this week. Help us to live according to your good plan and purpose. In Jesus' name we pray it all. Amen.
As we come to the Lord's table now, we remember the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, the blood that was shed on our behalf. Would you stand with me as we sing 467?
I will preach it all to you verbally, as I just did preach, but the sacrament is a sign. wine that Jesus was poured out, so that we would be spiritually satisfied. And so we come to him now, with all of our insufficiency, coming to him and looking to be fed, looking to be satisfied. And so we come to this table now as Christians, and I want to remind you that this is the meal for the body of Christ. If you are a member of the body of Christ, this is for you. But if you're not believing in Christ, then I ask you to let these items pass you by. We want to remember what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 11. He said, "Whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks the cup of sin in the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself." And so taking this warning from the Word of God, let's go to the Lord in prayer once again. And make sure that we are confessing all of our sins before him. So let's take a moment now just to respond to prayer and then a closing prayer. Father in heaven, we confess that we don't come to this table because we deserve it. Father, we recognize that we do not deserve it. We recognize before you that we are sinners who are desperately in need of your grace and salvation and healing that Jesus brings. Father, thank you for that grace that is offered to us here at this table. Father, thank you for the hope that we have that Jesus was born on our behalf. His blood was spilled so that we can be saved. Father, thank you. Lord, we ask that you would be present with us in this meal, that we would be able to be nourished and fed spiritually, that we would be able to share your gospel with others this week. Lord, thank you for what you've done on our behalf. In Jesus' name, amen. John? The same man here, he took a cup, and this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Gentlemen. Thank you.
We sing verses 4 and 5 of 467. Would you stand with me? Verse number 4.